Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. And I would like to welcome Liam Kerr and Michelle Thompson, who are joining us as new members of the committee, replacing Stephen Kerr and Bob Doris, respectively. And we thank Stephen Kerr and Bob Doris for their previous work and engagement as members of the committee. So our first item of business is to invite Mr Kerr and Ms Thompson to declare any relevant interests. Can we start with yourself, Liam?
Thank you, Convener. I have no registered interest to declare, but I think it's important that the committee and any witnesses and anyone watching knows that my wife is an ASN teacher in an Aberdeen school.
Thank you, Mr Kerr.
I have no relevant interest to declare.
Okay, thank you very much. Second item on our agenda today is the election of a new deputy convener. And the Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are eligible for nomination as deputy convener of this committee. And I understand that Ruth Maguire is the Scottish National Party's nominee. Do we agree to choose Ruth Maguire as our deputy convener?
Yes.
Agreed. Excellent. Thank you very much and congratulations, Ruth, on your appointment. The third item on our agenda is a decision to take business in private, and are members agreeing to take item 7 in private?
Okay.
Thank you. Now we can move on to the substantive items this morning. The next item on our agenda is evidence with the Scottish Qualification Authority, and can I welcome Fiona Robertson, the Chief Executive and Scotland's Chief Examining Officer of the SQA, and Dr. Jill Stewart, the SQA Director of Qualifications Development. Thank you both for joining us today. We will begin with a short opening statement from Fiona Robertson. You have around 2 minutes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener, and I will try and keep my opening remarks brief. First of all, thank you for the opportunity to appear before the committee today to reflect on national qualifications in 2023, to look ahead to next year and to discuss education reform. On results 2023, I'd like to begin by paying tribute to the 141,089 learners who received their SQA certificates on Tuesday the 8th of August this year. Those learners, including thousands within your own constituencies and communities, can feel proud of their achievements across a wide range of national and vocational qualifications. In celebrating the remarkable resilience and commitment of learners, I also want to pay tribute to all our teachers and lecturers who've supported them and our partners across the education and skills system who've helped shape and agree our approach to awarding. This year represents a further positive step on the path back to normal awarding, but the impact of pandemic disruption to learning and teaching continued to be felt. Recognising this, we put in place a wide-ranging package of support, including a sensitive approach to grading to help learners perform to the best of their abilities whilst maintaining the credibility of our qualifications. For awarding 2024, following extensive consultation with the education community, it was agreed that we'd return to full course assessment for most courses in the 23-24 session. Our wider approach to assessment will draw carefully upon the experience and evidence from this year and the views of learners and partners. Finally, on education reform, SQA has engaged positively with the Scottish Government's reform programme to replace SQA with a new qualifications body. We've also contributed to a range of reviews over the last few years, most recently the independent reviews of qualifications and assessment and the review of the skills delivery landscape. As a number of interconnected reviews have now come to a conclusion, great care will be needed to ensure that any change and reform that follows is coherent, well understood, aligned and deliverable. The timeline for the replacement of SQA has changed, but we remain committed to delivering high quality, credible qualifications, helping learners achieve their ambitions and deliver the skills for the future. Thank you. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Fiona Robertson. I will move on to questions from members, and I'll take convener privilege and I will have the first opening today. I suppose we know that we've had a very turbulent last few years with the pandemic impacting on results. So I think from a perspective, it's quite key to compare 2023 with 2019, I suppose, in terms of that benchmarking. So at a national level, how comparable are those results?
Well, I think I made clear on results day when we published information relating to the aggregate position for national courses that over the last few years, particularly given the pandemic and the years since, we've had to adopt a slightly different approach to awarding each year, in common with other awarding bodies across the UK. And on that basis, we need to be quite cautious about drawing comparisons, particularly in relation to any judgments about educational performance. But given that caveat, I think it's fair to say that we've seen some recovery, and that combined with a sensitive approach to grading has resulted in a strong set of results for this year. Learners have done well, they've shown great resilience, and they've worked hard, and I think that's evident in the results that we've seen. In terms of where the results sit, they sit somewhere between 2019 and 2022 overall.
Some of the data, you know, regarding attainment seems to indicate that since 2017 there's actually not been much noticeable improvement, with overall attainment at A to C marginally down at all levels compared to 2017. And we can also see that in 2019, before the pandemic, the attainment in A to C was starting to decline slightly. So where I am is I want to be able to see attainment across the board improving. So I'm concerned that since 2017 and even before the pandemic, there hasn't been what I'd like to see, is that overall improvement in attainment. And it just seems to be that attainment's either levelling out or tapering downwards. What are your comments on that?
Well, I think as I highlighted, I think we need to be cautious about drawing conclusions, but given the changes to awarding over the last few years, I think on a more granular level, you'll see variability in results in individual subjects at individual levels for a variety of reasons. And I think it's always important just to look below, if you like, the headline National 5 Higher and Advanced Higher results, and consider the issues. We're in the midst of publishing course reports for every subject at National 5 Higher and Advanced Higher, and that provides more information and reflection on performance in individual subjects, which can be helpful both to practitioners and to learners as they're approaching further learning and teaching this year. But I think I have to advise caution around comparisons. It can be for a variety of reasons. And as I say, the 2023 results I think are pretty strong overall, particularly given the challenges of the last few years. But we need to be cautious about drawing too many conclusions about the results.
I'm sure we'll pick in more on that thread as the session goes on. Can I move to questions now from Pam Duncan Clancy, please? Thanks, Pam.
Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for the information you've submitted in advance and also for your opening statement. Just a quick point on attainment. Mm-hmm. How would you describe the attainment gap between the years 2016 and 2019?
Well, we only since 2020 have we published published an equalities impact analysis on results day. So we've done that since 2020. I think certainly in the 2016 to 19 period, I think we've seen an attainment gap which persisted over that period of time. I think again, like overall results, you can see some slight variability over time. And when we published our equalities analysis this year, we did see some slight changes to the attainment gap in 2023 compared with 2022. Although again, I need to caution about drawing too much by way of conclusion. But I think it's an accepted fact in Scottish education that there is a persistent attainment gap in Scotland, and I know the government has made commitments to addressing that and investing in addressing that.
Thank you for that. I want to move on now to the sensitive approach that was taken during this.
If you can we can. Oh, Sorry, apologies, Pam. I'm first day back for me.
That's okay. The sensitive approach is that. Are you okay? Okay, thank you. The sensitive approach that was taken, as you've described
yes.
this year, can you tell us the impact of that sensitive approach and how you know?
The impact of the sensitive approach. Well, what we sought to do, and I set this out in more detail in a methodology report, which I also appended to the papers that I sent to the committee in advance of this session. The sensitive approach is a step-by-step approach that we take in individual awarding meetings for individual subjects. Now of course, colleagues, including members of the committee, are interested, obviously, in the aggregate position. But Jill and myself and another colleague chaired a series of meetings with teachers who are our senior markers and senior appointees this year to consider a range of evidence that would inform our grading decisions. And that's if you like, the final stage of the approach that we've taken. So I mentioned in my opening statement a package of support which included modifications to assessment, for example, which continued last year, which took out a range of assessment instruments to increase learning and teaching. What we did in our grading meetings was consider a range of evidence, as we would normally do, mm-hmm. about the performance of individual assessments. So how has the exam performed? How have young people performed in the exam? Has the exam and the assessment instruments performed as intended by the teachers who develop mm-hmm. and design our qualifications and our assessments? And we would also consider any impacts around the modifications, the removal of revision support, because we had revision support in 2022. And if necessary, we would consider whether there was any further adjustments that may be required mm-hmm. or appropriate as part of that sensitivity. Mm-hmm. And I think it's important to highlight that the sensitive grading was designed to benefit learners. Mm-hmm. So it's designed to be more generous if needed mm-hmm. and if the evidence supported that. So it's quite difficult for me to say the impact was X, because we held, I think, 129 grading meetings across National 5 Higher and Advanced Higher, and we took individualised decisions on that basis.
We published
our grade boundary adjustments on results day, and I also published the median. The median adjustment of grade boundaries as part of my chief examiner's report.
Thank you, and I appreciate that. And I found that report very helpful, including the detail on the sensitive approach and as you've set out. But are you able to set out what the results would have been had you not applied the sensitive approach?
No.
And so how do you know which parts of the sensitive approach helped, which parts were unhelpful, and how do you know that they are not needed into the following year?
I mean, I think what I've set out in summary and what the methodology report sets out is what we did.
I appreciate that.
And actually, we did not, and I think for all the right reasons, we did not say this particular percentage is the sensitive approach, because we took an evidence-based approach to grading and considered with our senior appointees whether there was an adjustments needed, and bearing in mind looking at the performance of assessments, looking at the impact of modifications, the impact of the removal of revision support, and any further so there's effectively a holistic judgment made on the basis of an individual subject. So we have not and did not make or provide or quantify what that sensitive approach would be. However, as my chief examiner's report highlights, in a normal year, the grade boundary adjustment, the median grade boundary adjustment is zero. Okay, so if you go back to 2019 and the period before, the median grade boundary adjustment was zero. Last year, so in 2022, it was -4 at C, and minus 2 at A. And this year it was around minus 2 at C and minus 1 at A. So that does highlight in broad terms the fact that we took steps, and we took steps beyond what we would normally take for a variety of reasons, but we took steps beyond what we would normally make in a normal year. So that kind of demonstrates in broad terms the quantum of the adjustments that we made, which were larger than usual. And bearing in mind minus means that we lowered the boundary at C, we lowered the boundary at A, and therefore more learners achieved A to C.
Thank you. Willie Rennie, do you have a supplementary in this?
Yeah, it's just a quick one. You said we shouldn't draw comparisons between now and prior to the pandemic, but then you were confident that things had got better. Is that not a contradiction?
No, because I think it goes back to those discussions that we had during June and early July that Jill and myself were part of, where we saw evidence of strong performance, we saw evidence of some improvements in performance, and actually the fact that the grade boundary adjustments were less significant this year than last highlights evidence of some recovery. So there's that balance between recognising that there was that we are on a path to recovery, but also recognising that we continue to take a sensitive approach to grading to benefit learners. But I think it's really important that we're not. I do have to stress that in every year since 2019, circumstances have necessitated that we have had to take a slightly different approach to awarding. And that has led to different sets of results in different years. And therefore, we need to be cautious about seeing this education improvement overall or not, as the case may be. We have had to make some adjustments, but I think it's important to highlight that we saw evidence of strong performance and compared with 2022, a degree of recovery.
Thank you. Can I, Willie, let Mr. Rick, because I know Mr. Kerr, Liam Kerr, wants to come in on this topic, so we're going to jump ahead a little bit to him before we come back. Okay.
Very grateful, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to just stay with this line of questioning, if I may, about grade boundaries and sensitive approach. But first of all, because I appreciate there'll be people watching this and hearing all these terms and hearing you talk about grade boundaries and minus two and things, are you able to concisely, up front, just say that these grade boundaries that you set each year, that in your submission you say are not predetermined, they're based on evidence, you talked about the median grade being adjustment being zero, are you able just to set out concisely what you mean by grade boundaries, what it is to be adjusted, and what the evidence is that you use to do that?
Yes, I'll attempt to set that out clearly. And I accept and recognise, and I hope the committee also appreciate that this is a technical process, but absolutely, I think we're very conscious of the fact that there are learners yeah. behind all of this, and we're very cognisant of that. So we do have a policy in relation to grade boundaries, and that's published, so there's transparency around all of that. Basically, the grade boundary is the grade at which you achieve a particular grade. And so there's a grade boundary set at C, and we also set a grade boundary at A and upper A. And it's effectively the marks at which you achieve a particular grade. Now, in our assessment, our assessments are set with the expectation that grade boundaries will be notional. Now, notional means that, on average, you would expect a grade A to be 70%, you'd expect a C grade rather to be 50% and a grade A to be 70%. That would be an expectation, and the assessment would be set with that in mind. But setting assessments is there are judgments that are made, and my colleague Jill Stewart can talk about that in more detail. Jill has many years of experience in this particular area. Oftentimes assessments perform as expected, but sometimes they don't. So there can be modest grade boundary adjustments to allow for that. So in very simple terms, sometimes an assessment is easier than expected, and sometimes an assessment is harder than expected. So we can make modest adjustments to account for that. And because and at the heart of it, at the heart of what this is that a grade A in 1 year would be broadly speaking the same as a grade A in another year. So we make adjustments to deal with that. So that's what grade boundary boundary adjustments are.
That's really helpful. And on that adjustment, in your submission, you said that when you were looking at setting grade boundaries, the SQA took into account the legacy impact of the pandemic upon learning and teaching. Yes. How did the SQA evaluate the impact of the pandemic and quantify it when you were setting grade boundaries?
So the methodology report sets that out in a bit more detail around a staged approach. So the normal awarding approach would be to look at a range of evidence about how assessments had performed. So we would look at a range of evidence. I think in the last couple of years, with a slight adjustment to our grading, we've also looked at a range of other evidence, and we've taken a judgment about whether there's any further adjustments that we should make, which don't undermine the integrity of the qualification, but recognise that there have been impacts. I think Jill might be able to exemplify a couple of examples, for example, in the sciences and languages, and that might bring this to life a little bit, because I understand that this may feel rather dry, but it is important, and it's an important part of our process. And it's evidence-based. It's evidence-based, and it's seeking to ensure that year on year there's fairness in our approach. And I think that's really important that I highlight.
And
that.
Dr. Stewart, then, to give us some live examples, helpfully. Right.
Okay. Thanks. I think the best example I can think of is the modern languages one. So we assess, as you would expect, the skills of reading, writing, talking, and listening, and we assess those separately, so we can see how. Learners have done in each of those assessments. So I think it's important to realise the breadth of evidence that we consider. So we look at statistical information, which helps us to determine whether or not the assessment performed as intended. But we also ask all of the markers, and there's over 8,000 teachers and lecturers involved in marking, to complete a marking report when they've completed their marking, to ask them information about whether or not they thought learners had done, how they thought learners had done relative to 2019 and relative to 2022. We also have teacher estimates as well as part of our panoply of information. And we also have the principal assessor and the deputy principal assessor, who have overseen all the setting of the assessments and the marking of the assessments, and they have looked at all of the markers' reports. So we use all of that evidence to make those judgments. So if I come to the modern languages example, so first of all, we would compare performance in each of the reading, talking, listening, writing, against 2019. So that's the original standard, that we're trying to get back to in terms of what we expect our learners to have at National 5 or higher. So that would tell us where we are relative to our original standards. But then we would look at performance this year across those four assessment areas in relation to last year. And what that told us was there had been significant recovery in 23 in comparison to 2022. So we used the comparison between 2019 and 22 to see what the impact of the pandemic had been upon the learning and make a judgment the previous year. But then moving forward to this year in 23, we were able to compare how they had performed in reading, writing, listening and talking this year compared to last year, and that told us that there had been another stepwise recovery in the learner's skills, but they were still a little bit off the 2019 standards. Does that help?
I understand.
Languages specifically, I think we saw an impact particularly around listening and talking, for example, because, the disruption to learning had an impact. So we saw perhaps a weaker performance in relation to those elements last year, still slightly weaker this year, but a bit of an improvement on last year. And last year we made a significant adjustment to address that because we felt that was the right thing to do, and that's part of the generous grading. This year we still made an adjustment, but it was not as significant as last year. The methodology report does set out that stepwise approach.
Thank you.
Very much in line with...
Yeah.
Yeah, that does make sense, and I'm
consistently, but also crucially involving principal assessors and deputy principal assessors who are teachers and bringing feedback from them as part of this judgment that we make.
I'm very grateful. That does make it clear. It begs one final question, mm-hmm. if I may, which is it then your intention to take the sensitive approach next year? And if not, is that because you've concluded that there is no longer a legacy impact of the pandemic?
Well, as I set out in my opening statement and in all the documentation that I published on the 8th of August, I think we have a balance to strike. And this is not just a balance that we consider, but it's a balance that other awarding bodies and other regulators are considering across the UK and have considered across the UK. We need to make sure that we're recognising the challenges of the last few years and the impact that that's had on learning and teaching and on learners. And we need to balance that with the ongoing credibility of the qualifications and that we're on a path back to normal. This year we saw England substantially return to normal awarding with some protections in place. There's an expectation that Wales and Northern Ireland will follow this coming year. We've not made a final decision in relation to our grading approach for this year. We have made, as I outlined in my opening statement, we have made a decision around full course assessment for this year. So that's bringing things like practical work back into science and assignments back into a range of our courses as they were designed to do. And we will be engaging and discussing further final awarding and grading approaches. I would hope that we can substantially get back to normal. However, I think given that we've returned to full course assessment, I think we need to, as we would normally do with any changes to the assessment approach, we need to be mindful of the impact that might have. Yeah, I'm very aware of the fact that some teachers have expressed concern about the return to full course assessment, particularly for those learners who have gone through S4 and S5 without having done some of that work. So I think we need to be very mindful of that in our grading approach and where the evidence takes us on that.
Thank you very much. Bill Kidd, can I come to you now for your questions, please?
Yes, thank you, convener, and thank you to the panel. Now, National 4 Advanced Higher and Local Authority Centres is something, just a couple of quick questions. I don't think they go very deep, but can the panel explain the rise in number of entries at National 4 level that have taken place?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've seen, centres make decisions in the best interest of their learners, and that includes decisions on entries. So it's quite difficult for me to give a granular explanation for any changes. What we have certainly seen is, over the last couple of years, and compared to pre-pandemic levels, we've seen an increase in dual entries at National 4 and National 5. And I think there probably has been a bit of a shift from National 3 into National 4, and similarly we've actually seen fairly stable a greater degree of stability at higher and advanced higher, but we have seen the number of National 5 entries go up, and a big part of that is dual entries between National 4 and National 5. And I think that we have also seen a bit of a shift from National 3 to National 4. Now, modifications may form part of that story because we removed the added value unit from the National 4 qualification, again, in response to the pandemic and the disruption to learning. So, again, freeing up time for learning and teaching. That could have had an impact on entry patterns and entry levels. But entry levels, sorry, entry decisions, rather, rightly are a decision for centres to take in the best interests of their learners. And I think we have seen, while the focus, and I'm sure the focus will remain in this discussion at National 5 Higher and Advanced Higher, you know, fairly consistently, we have also seen increases in our other awards, you know, PDA, Skills for Work and other awards. We're seeing quite healthy numbers there. And, of course, we offer a wide range of other qualifications that we're seeing coming through, including in the school sector, vocational qualifications, including HNCs, modern apprenticeships, include SQA qualifications substantially. So we are seeing also a bit of diversification of entry patterns. And that's, I think that should be seen as a positive thing because that's recognising that there are choices for learners to suit their interests and their pathways.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. On the back of that then, to what degree is the SQA seeking a return to the previous achievement patterns, the ones that existed before the pandemic? Is the SQA seeking to do that, or is it looking to see new patterns emerge?
There is not predetermination in our resulting. So, you know, as I say, in terms of entry, decisions that centres might take, they'll have a range of choices in relation to that. And as I've highlighted to your colleagues, we take an evidence-based approach in terms of resulting and the outcomes of our qualifications. I mean, the responsibility that SQA has is to make sure that we can judge the competence and the, you know, skills, knowledge and understanding that's required to achieve a qualification, and it's on that basis that we make our judgments. So there's no predetermination around final outcomes.
Okay. Would the SQA be happy, at least initially, to return to the achievement patterns that were seen before the pandemic? Or I know you're saying that you're not setting exact sort of limits or rules, but those patterns which existed before the pandemic, were they good enough to want to go back to?
Well, as I say, it's not really, my focus is not really about achieving a particular pattern of achievement. My job is to ensure that we're awarding on merit and on the evidence that's in front of us. So I don't have a predetermined view about that. I mean, I think everyone involved in Scottish education wants Scottish education there to be improved outcomes and good pathways for young people. I think that goes without saying. But I think our role is very clear in relation to ensuring that we are making awards on the basis of demonstrated attainment and achievement. Yeah. So I think I hope that answers your question.
Yes, it does. Yeah, thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Can I bring in Ross Greer for a supplementary on this line of questioning?
Thanks, Ross. Is the issue here not that the grading is ultimately relative, that by the way that the system that we operate by, there can only really be so many A's each year, so many B's, so many C's, and for example, if the number of A grades in the first instance looks like it's increased significantly, that's interpreted as a question over the integrity of the data, and that the approach to grade boundaries ultimately sets a cap on the number of A grades that there can actually be each year.
No, I think there is absolutely something in terms of you expect in the external assessments that we set, you expect to see a degree of differentiation in performance. And actually questions are set with that in part. Some subjects more than others. But I might use maths as an obvious example, that there are some questions that are set as perhaps A-type questions or B-type questions and so on. As Jill has highlighted, our markers will provide feedback on the performance of those assessments and how those particular assessment instruments have performed. If there was a cap, or if there was a predetermination, we would see much less variability than we do see in our awarding. And if you're looking at individual subjects, and of course there are about around 140 National 5 Higher and Advanced Higher courses, and some with very small numbers of entries, when in fact there can be quite high degrees of variability year on year because of the cohort, the impact of a particular cohort. And for larger subjects, obviously there's a spread and therefore perhaps a bit more stability in outcomes overall. But every year you will see differences and changes. So on the one hand, yes, the assessments are set with a degree of differentiation in mind, absolutely. But we do see variation in performance each year, and we do have a considered and evidence-based approach before we make a judgment about grading. I mean, I don't want to over or indeed under-emphasise the importance of the grade boundary meetings. As I've highlighted, in a normal year, the median adjustment is zero. So for the most part, assessments work. We make no adjustments to grade boundaries, and therefore the results fall where they fall. Over the last couple of years, we have made more adjustments to grade boundaries as part of a more generous approach to grading, which has benefited learners. And we've provided the grade boundary information, and as I say, we publish it every year, and that highlights that there were a number of courses where we made quite significant grade boundary adjustments, and there were a large number of courses where we didn't. It was very much on a case by case basis. So I hope that explains that there isn't a predetermination or a cap, because okay. Actually we do see variability year on year. And you would expect to see that in courses that have a small number of entries. There will be years in which there is really strong performance, and there may be years in which there is perhaps less strong performance, and it's really important that we reflect that in our results.
Thank you. I suppose I'm going to carry on this theme, if that's okay, because you've spoken about median adjustments and results falling where they fall, and you specifically spoke about larger subjects like maths, where you use that example specifically there. So despite the sensitive approach to boundaries that we've been discussing at length so far, the results in National 5 Maths and English were worse or the same as 2019. So does the SQA have particular concerns around these, what are key qualifications? And if so, how are you feeding back to local authorities, schools and teachers to address some of the gaps in learning? Dr. Stewart, do you want to come in on that at all?
Yeah. I think just to add to what Fiona said about grade boundaries, our job is to maintain standards from year to year in individual subjects. And it's through the setting of the assessments in a standardised way each year, and then using the grade boundaries process to assess whether or not we have maintained those standards, or whether or not it was slightly more challenging or slightly easier than intended. And that's very much the purpose of grade boundaries. As Fiona said, we've made other adjustments to do with the pandemic in our generous and sensitive approach to grading, to take account of the impact of the pandemic upon learning. National 5 Mathematics is an interesting area, because there's lots going on there. There's a number of different factors at play, and we're carrying out further analysis of all the data to help us to understand and to have discussions with local authorities and teachers and so on. But some of the things that we see happening there are we see a larger proportion of dual entries for National 4 and National 5. So we see that. We've also got, we don't just have one course in mathematics, we have a course called National 5 Applications of Maths, and we've seen significant increases in the uptake of that qualification. I think we're sitting at something like 19,000 from memory, but it's gone up from 14,000 last year to 19,000 this year. So we're seeing a shift in the use of the different mathematics courses as well as these patterns of dual entry. The other factor that we have to take into account here is National 5 mathematics is often required by learners to go into particular further courses of study, be that at college or at university. And so we see significant numbers of resets for National 5. So if you take out the resit population and you just look at those in S4 who are sitting National 5 mathematics, the attainment rate is sitting at something like 70, just over 70%. If you then take out the dual entries for National 4 and National 5, the attainment rate goes up to 80-odd percent. So there's a lot going on, and there's also different patterns happening across different local authorities and different schools, but we're doing a lot more analysis in order to understand that more fully, because we need to understand, to have dialogue with Education Scotland and local authorities if we think there are.
As Dr. Stewart, what you've explained there, I suppose, is you're explaining the number of extra entries, not the results that are coming from those. So I was wondering if you could make... And I also consider, I asked about English as well, where I don't know if there is quite as many. So if you don't mind, I'm directing the question to Dr. Stewart again.
Yeah. You have... the other course in mathematics is significant because if you've got a variable cohort, which you do have here, and the decisions are getting made locally about which learners will go to National 5 Applications of Maths or National 5 Mathematics, you don't know if that's a uniform spread of learners across the ability range or not. So, for instance, it might be that the better learners are going to National 5 Applications of Maths. You don't know, because now the cohort that previously all did National 5 Maths are now split across two mathematics courses, and you also have significant numbers doing both courses as well. So I'm not providing answers, I'm just saying there's a lot of new variables that have come into play here that mean that we really need to go down to a lot more higher degree of analysis of what's happening at a local level, what's happening across different year groups, and also what's happening in National 5 applications.
The opportunity for you to feedback, I'll bring you in a second, Fiona, when you've done that, which sounds like it's going to be quite a substantive piece of work, to feedback to us around some of the findings from that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that'd be super. Mm-hmm. Fiona Robertson, if you can respond briefly on my question.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, just to add to what Jill has said, I mean, obviously, in any year, local authorities and schools will be looking at their results and undertaking an analysis and reflecting on learning, teaching, also entry patterns as well, because, you know, the percentages, you know, there's a focus on percentages here. Well, actually, percentages are in part defined by the entry decisions that local centres are taking. And there's only so much we can say about that those are local decisions made. And local authorities have statutory responsibilities in relation to, you know, improving education and considering these issues more generally. We will play our part in providing data and analysis to aid that thinking. I would say, though, that my chief examiner's report did highlight a weaker performance in maths. I mean, that's what we saw. But as Jill highlighted, there was underneath all of that, there are some unusual patterns on entries, and the point about resets I think is important. There's not many courses in which There's a substantial number of resits, resitting candidates. Maths is an exception to that, and actually has been previously, so it's not new. But I think that this is an opportunity for where the data that we, that the results that we publish and the data that we produce can aid further conversation in the system, including in local authorities and in schools and in government about some wider issues in the education system, and that's part of our role.
Thanks. Can I also ask briefly about entries into the Gaelic medium qualifications, because these still remain stubbornly low, relatively low. So have you undertaken any work to understand the reasons for that? Dr. Stewart.
We could come back to you with further information about that. I mean, we do have our Gaelic language plan, and we support, mm-hmm. you know, the medium of Gaelic in education. But I suppose we're limited by the provision at a local level. Again, it's schools that make the entries and so on. So, but we do our bit to support Gaelic medium education and provide, you know, assessments in the medium of Gaelic in a small number of subject areas. And we also have our Gaelic learners courses and our native speaking Gaelic courses as well, you know, to help.
That would be very helpful if you could provide that information when you have it. excuse me. Mr. Rennie, Willie Rennie, can I continue?
It's in the same light. Advanced hires in disadvantaged areas. Advanced hires in disadvantaged areas. Have we got on top of why there is a lower offer, a less of an offer in those schools? And what do you think can be done about it to improve it if it's not improved in recent years?
I think that's an area where it's quite difficult for us to comment actually in any detail. The provision, the availability of courses and the provision within local authorities and centres more generally is ultimately a matter for them. There have certainly been some, there certainly in advanced hire provision specifically, there certainly has been some movement there, you know, with the hub at Glasgow Caledonian, for example, you know, the scholar resources for particular courses as well at advanced hire. So there has been some movement there. But ultimately, we offer a very wide range of courses, including at advanced higher level. Some of the advanced hires, I would acknowledge, are quite small entries, you know, quite small entries. But what we're finding is that learners are taking a variety of, are making a variety of choices, in particular in S6. That sometimes includes advanced hires, sometimes it includes other qualifications. It can include vocational offering, so we are seeing a bit of diversification, but those decisions are made at a local level.
You have a strategic overview across the country. You'll have developed an expertise and understanding about perhaps what works in some areas and what doesn't. Do you have regular discussions with local authorities about how to improve that offer in certain localities?
We engage with centres, with local authorities, with ADES, the Directorate of Education, on a regular basis, on these issues. And actually, advanced hire provision is not something that comes up. It's not coming up on all the time on a regular basis.
Do you not think it should? I mean, there's quite a big gap between the wealthier areas and the poorer areas. Should that not be on your red risk register?
Well, I mean, as I say, I mean, our role is to offer qualifications. I mean, I think we would all want to see choices being made available to learners wherever they live. Of course, those same choices being made available to learners wherever they live. But ultimately, that is a decision that does not rest with SQA, that rests with local authorities and with individual centres. As I say, there has been some movement in schools working together and at Glasgow Caledonian around, you know, making sure there is that volume, so that some courses can be that are more viable for on the basis of a volume. But these are, you know, the availability of courses and curricular decisions are decisions that are made locally.
Thank you. There. Dr. Stewart. Yeah.
It was just to say, not specifically on advanced higher, but I know that Education Scotland are doing some work currently, which is about showcasing best practice. It's particularly in relation to diversification of the curriculum. Yeah. So they're looking at different models that are being used across different local authorities, you know, so that we can spread the word around about some of that, and we're working with them in that space.
That's helpful.
And we've also done some work with SEQF, the SEQF partnership around pathways as well. So there are things that we can do, but I think ultimately the curriculum decisions and the availability of courses is a complex issue, which is but also a decision which local decision makers and local authorities and individual schools make on the basis of the needs of their local school community.
Thank you. You've alluded to some of the other courses there in the response to Mr. Rennie's questioning. So continuing on this theme, can we bring in Pam Duncan Clancy, please?
Thank you very much. Can you explain the rise in entries for non-vocational the work courses and also for the National Progression Award?
Well, I think what we are seeing is, I was at Leith Academy last week and I witnessed the value of that diversification of choices that learners are making. So while absolutely learners continue to make choices in relation to National 5, higher and advanced higher provision, there's also a range of other qualifications that they can take throughout the year and indeed can be certificated throughout the year, both in the senior phase and in some cases before the senior phase commences. So I think that's good to see. So National Progression Awards, for example, PDAs, we do lots of different awards, mental health awards and other things, and we have been seeing some quite healthy growth. Again, it does boil down to individual decisions that are being taken within schools around the diversification of the curriculum and the opportunities that are being made available to learners. And there is still some variability across the country in that context. And that's absolutely something to be celebrated, that individual schools are thinking about these things and thinking about, well, what will best suit the needs of learners. I think it does, but it also brings into, and I think that the conversation that the question that Mr. Rennie just asked in relation to advanced hires, I think there's also a debate to be had about whether there's some things that should, you know, the entitlements of learners, and I know that came up in some of the Hayward review discussions about whether there should be more consistency. So there's a balance to be struck there, and I think that's a debate that the education system needs to have. Insofar as we're concerned in the SQA, there's a huge amount of, I mean, we offer, our catalogue of qualifications is wide, it's deep, there's lots of choices, there's lots of choices that can be made. So the offer is there, the issue is the choices and the availability of courses within schools and within colleges and others.
And do we know anything about the demographics of the numbers of people who are going forward in these circumstances?
That's not analysis that we've undertaken.
And is it analysis you could undertake? If it feels like it would be useful for the committee to understand some of the demographics of that increase.
That may be something that we could look at. I mean, we've published the Equalities Impact report. We don't actually hold that information. We have to engage with the Scottish Government who hold that information in relation to SIMD. And it's not just SIMD, it's also other characteristics as well. So we don't hold that information. But that's something that we can certainly look at as part of our wider equalities work.
I think it's really positive to see schools, you know, diversify in their curriculum, because I can't remember which OECD report that said that, you know, young people can be motivated by, you know, I want to go to university or whatever, but some young people are not motivated by that, and they're looking for something that they're good at, and sometimes a skills for work course in a vocational area or a national progression award in cyber security or whatever might really engage that young person and get them interested in learning, and they can actually find out they're good at something, you know, which is really, really important to encourage them in their learning. So I think it's a really, really positive move that we're seeing increases in uptake of vocational qualifications in our school, trying to engage young people in, you know, what would help them on their next steps in their career. And the work that Education Scotland's doing is trying to help spread good practice in some areas and to help schools understand how they could do some of that as well, which is really good. And Fiona mentioned the work that we've done with SCQF. As you said, we've got a very broad catalogue, but it's trying sometimes to identify which bits of that broad catalogue might be appropriate for use in schools and just highlighting some of that. So, for example, in computing, we know there are some young people that aren't particularly good at programming, which you need to be for National 5 computing, but they are interested in, you know, things to do with cyber security, gaming, data analysis, all these different things, software development. And so we have lots of small qualifications in those areas that some schools are using with those learners and really getting good engagement with those learners. But because National 5 computing isn't for them, but it's suitable for some young people that want to go on and do programming, but not for others. Sorry, I just used that wee example.
No, we like examples on this committee, don't we?
We do, and I think that's a really good example, so thank you for sharing it. I think what we're seeing in those particular awards is helpful, and I think that diversification is really important, not least because the OECD had picked it out, but just because we understand that that's what young people want. I just think it's also really important for us to know who's going forward, who's being presented for those, as opposed to who's being presented elsewhere, to check if there's any kind of patterns that may be needing looked at further.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Stephanie Callaghan now, can I thank you for your patience this morning.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, so far. Just looking at the variation in results associated with SIMD areas, I'm wondering why different approaches to certification can lead to significantly different attainment gaps. And can you explain what's actually behind that? It's maybe a question perhaps more for Dr. Stewart.
I think it's very difficult to say definitively what might lie behind that. But what I can say is that the wider research evidence would say that if you have teacher judgment, they will be more likely to make more generous judgments on the performance of learners, particularly those from lower SIMD, less advantaged backgrounds, if you see what I mean. And you know, there's research that also shows differences between different protected characteristics as well. In the broader, I'm talking about broader research about teacher judgments, not specifically about research to do with Scotland and national courses and so on. So there might be some natural bias towards, but there could be all sorts of things going on. I don't think you can say uniformly that one form of assessment, either teacher assessment or external assessment, will suit one, you know, less advantaged learners or advantaged learners, because learners are a mixture. You know, some will respond better to teacher assessment, some will respond better to examinations and coursework than others. It's not a kind of uniform population. Do you see what I mean, Stephanie? Maybe didn't explain that very well, but you know, we all have our preferences in terms of how we like to learn, and similarly, we all have our preferences about how we'd like to be assessed. You know, so often boys prefer, you know, to be assessed via an exam rather than some boys prefer to be assessed via an exam rather than continuous assessment. But there'll be some boys that will prefer continuous assessment. So that there's a lot of variation in the population, and I don't think you can say, people, less disadvantaged people prefer teacher assessment and more advantaged prefer... I know you're not saying that, but...
I suppose it would be quite interesting, if there was any further work to be carried on around this, to maybe look at that in a little bit more detail. But kind of carrying on from that as well there, the attainment gaps seem to be lower, generally speaking. So maybe over the past 5 years, the higher the level of qualification, then the smaller the gaps seem to be in attainment. And I'm wondering, what's the thinking behind that? Is there any reasoning? Is there an explanation for why that is?
Shall I come in there? I think there's no doubt with alternative certification in 2020 and 2021, we saw quite a different pattern of attainment. We saw teachers awarding higher grades overall. And when you look at the composition of the attainment gap, if you're moving what would have been in 2019 or 2018 an attainment pattern that we had to a more generous attainment pattern that was achieved in 2020 and 2021, a result of that would be a narrowing of the gap. And that wasn't just seen in Scotland; that was seen in the rest of the UK as well. So it's a common feature of our alternative certification. I think, interestingly, in the return to exams last year, we published some research which looked at teacher estimates compared with the results that were achieved through external assessment. And I would certainly recommend you have a look at that report, because we actually saw teacher estimates return broadly speaking to pre-pandemic. To be pre-pandemic levels, and we will also produce some further analysis on the position this year. So actually, this year and last year, we saw actually a very similar pattern of results from awarding through external assessment and the return to exams as we did as teacher estimates came in. I think that's quite interesting because actually over the last couple of years we've also seen a changing pattern in teacher estimates compared to 20 and 21. You mentioned research. We have undertaken some really significant research over the last couple of years, and we will do another evaluation of 23 awarding. And that's given rise to some really interesting observations about how people felt about alternative certification, how people felt about continuous assessment, and of course also how people felt about the return to exams, and we surveyed learners, practitioners, parents, carers, as well as those that work most closely with us, particularly appointees. And there's some really interesting conclusions. So, for example, learners absolutely trust the judgment of their teachers. So they absolutely trust that judgment. But we also found we're looking at the evaluation of the 2021 approach for alternative certification, that while they absolutely trusted the judgment of their teachers, there was a concern that perhaps the judgment of those that were not their teachers or those that were in another centre were questioned. So the distinction between the absolute the judgment of the individual versus the relative judgment of others. And that's why we have a national awarding system rather than a local awarding system. So there are some really interesting observations and findings that absolutely should feed into what happens next. And just the final thing I would say is that we do actually have a pretty balanced assessment system. Yes, we have. We absolutely do have an exam system at present, but the courses have been designed to be balanced, and many courses have a significant amount of coursework. Some have teacher assessment and continuous assessment of some kind or different components which are assessed during the year. So there is some balance across our courses, and that continues to be the case. And so, I would advocate for that balance.
So just on the second question, yes, that I asked there as well, are you able to explain why the attainment gap gets smaller the higher the level of qualifications? So, for example, at advanced higher level, it's smaller than it is at National 5 and higher level?
I think we'd have to do more analysis on that, but if you're asking for my kind of thoughts on that, rather mm-hmm. than, it would be that the numbers doing the qualifications significantly reduce, so it's a much smaller population that are doing advanced higher in comparison to, and it's probably, and it will be by its very nature, a much more select group of young people that will do advanced hires. But we would have to do further analysis to kind of really interrogate that and see what the patterns were and so on, and also speak to others about, you know, we can identify what the patterns are, but we can't necessarily explain why those patterns are thus.
So I'm just wondering, up until this point, why has there not been some kind of curiosity in looking into that aspect of it? Is it not something that's kind of stood out as something that perhaps does need to be looked at?
Yeah, I mean, I think...
In a positive way, yeah, of course.
No, so we provided the equalities impact analysis. You're absolutely right. I mean, in broad terms, compared to 2022... albeit with the caveats around comparisons, and I think that is important because there's a different awarding approach. We did see a slight widening of the gap between 22 and 23, narrowing of the gap between 2019 and 2023, but advanced higher looked a little different, and we actually saw a slight narrowing of the gap this year.
Just to be really clear, this has been kind of over the past 5 years or so it's not just been during the COVID period.
I mean, I think the contributors to any changes in the attainment gap are absolutely, you know, it goes back to Mr. Rennie's question around entry levels and where those entries are coming from. That's the first thing. The achievement of individual learners, and for some advanced higher courses, you are seeing greater variability in performance year on year because it's a smaller cohort, and that can impact on the attainment gap. So there are a variety of factors that can contribute to that. But I think it's important to highlight that the analysis that we're undertaking is a national analysis. We're not looking at individual local authorities in that analysis, or indeed individual schools. And I think it's in terms of, you know, there's a government programme, the Attainment Challenge, and it's important that they are looking at that data and looking and interrogating that data. And Education Scotland, of course, are very heavily involved in that, in seeking to understand and inform what further approaches should be taken, both around learning and teaching, around particular support, or indeed in relation to entries. But I think our analysis is prompting some of those questions, and that can be a good thing.
Thank you, Stephanie Callaghan. Can I move to questions from Ross Greer now, please? Thank you, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to ask a few questions about the appeals system. So obviously changed quite a bit over the last few years for a variety of reasons, most obviously, but not entirely due to the pandemic. And the 2022 appeals system was one that I think was probably received the most positive welcome from young people, organisations that represent them and their rights. So we had an appeal system that was direct access for young people, that was free, and that considered evidence in the round. It wasn't just a script remarking service. Obviously, we've gone back from that, although maybe that's a subjective term, but we've moved away from that for this year. It's gone to script remarking again. Could you explain what the rationale behind that decision to go back to script remarking was, and specifically what the issues presumably were with last year's appeals service that was based on young people, wider evidence of young people's work throughout the year?
Okay, so I'll try and be succinct, but there's a number of things that we looked at. So just first of all, in terms of the 2022 appeals service that was introduced, we felt there'd been 2 years in which there'd been no exams, And we felt, therefore, as part of the package of support for 1 year only, we'd put an appeals process in place. And it was much considered and discussed, including with learners, including with the wider community, that we would put in place an appeal service, unusually, that was based on that could be based on alternative evidence. So it wasn't an appeal service that was based on the exam or the remarking of the script, i.e. it wasn't an appeal service which was based on whether we'd marked it incorrectly, which would be a typical appeal service, not just in Scotland but everywhere else, but an appeal service that could look at alternative evidence taken forward during the course of the year in terms of learning and teaching and assessment. So we did that. As you've highlighted, again, unusually, because it's not available elsewhere, and certainly not in the UK, a direct appeal service, which is also free. So I think you're right, absolutely, that was welcomed. And actually, we continue to have a free and direct appeal service this year. While we had announced that the appeal service in 2022, which was based on alternative evidence, was for 1 year only, it was absolutely right and proper that we looked at that as part of our evaluation, and we took forward a lot of discussion about the appeal service, about what people had felt about it, what the views were, but also what the evidence was as well. And I think we concluded, as part of the feedback that we got, and that was feedback from learners, from practitioners, from appointees who were involved in looking at the evidence. There was almost 60,000 appeals. And if you can imagine, that involved collecting evidence from every centre that was submitting evidence. And that was looked at by our appointees, also teachers. I think the biggest issue was actually fairness. So on the one hand, while the appeals process based on alternative evidence was perceived to be fair and was perceived to be generous in the sense that if you didn't perform in your exam on the day, you could look back and you could look back at your alternative work. That worked for some. That worked for some learners. So about 3 out of 10 learners who appealed got a higher grade as a result. But 7 out of 10 did not. And keep in mind that you could only make an appeal if your teacher estimate was above your exam grade. So the expectation was that the evidence and the judgment of your teacher was that you would have done better than you did in your exam.
Those numbers, the 3 and the 7 out of 10, how does that compare to what it would usually be with a script remarking service?
It was a little more, but not much. But bearing in mind that a normal, it's kind of apples and oranges. It's not apples and apples in the sense that
presumably you get far fewer appeals with script remarking than you did last year.
Yes, and it's on a different basis, really, in a sense. So I think we've got to be careful about drawing comparisons between success or otherwise rates. But actually, the consistent feedback we got from markers was that there were issues around the sufficiency of evidence from schools, and there were, in some cases, issues around the judgments that schools had reached around the estimate itself. And actually, that does call to fairness. I dealt myself with a number of individual cases in which learners, through no fault of their own, had not been assessed properly, or indeed that there had been an inappropriate judgment made about the standard that they were expected to achieve. So sufficiency of evidence, which means breadth of evidence, so that we had evidence that we could look at and say, yes, on balance, this learner's, could have got another award, but also the standard at which that evidence was judged. So it was really on the basis of variability in the standard and breadth of evidence through that approach. There was also emerging evidence that if you have an appeals process of the type that I'm explaining, if you have an appeals process which is based on alternative evidence, that in itself, particularly over time, And we had a similar appeals process, it's before my time, but the pre-2014 period, we had a similar appeals process. And over time, what happens is that for all the understandable reasons, schools start to collect evidence on the off chance that they need an appeal, and it actually promotes potentially over assessment. It creates workload for learners and for teachers, and we did get some practitioner feedback around concerns about workload both for learners, and because we don't want learners to be over assessed on the basis of the fact that they may need an appeal further down the line.
Yeah, can I just come in on that point, because I completely understand the concern about over-assessment, and particularly the challenges that we saw in 2021 trying to manage for the lack of exams and then the concern about over-assessment there. But in that period between 2014 and the pandemic, the scriptory marking service that we moved towards, because that was... Now, this is partly because of cost, etc., but the scriptory marking rather than assessment system was disproportionately used by... independent schools. So I get the concerns around fairness here, but the script remarking system that we used and that we have now returned to has its own evidenced issues with fairness as well.
So again, I mean, going back to kind of apples and apples, I mean, the pre-pandemic service is not the service that we now have. The pre-pandemic service, you're right, and I understand there were issues, and that it predates me in this role, but there were issues around the fact that the service was determined by a school decision rather than a learner decision. It was also in the knowledge that if the appeal was unsuccessful, the local authority would be charged. So the charging system presented a perception that could influence behaviour, hence including any judgment about independent schools and ability to pay, etc., and all of that. And so the cost kind of got into, you know, the cost became part of that, the perception around that service. So what we have now is we have a free service. It's an open service. Anyone can appeal any subject. It's a learner direct appeal. It is a click of a button. That learners can appeal, but it is an appeal on the basis of the assessment instrument that's been used. So it's an appeal on the basis on which their grade has been determined.
Yeah, but to cut in, I'm just very conscious of time. That's the core issue, because it comes back to the debate that we've had over the last couple of years and discussions that I've had with yourself around those exceptional circumstances, the young people who... Yeah. Had a family bereavement immediately before the exam, had a panic attack during the exam, whatever it might be. And I've brought some of those cases to you as casework. We've had wider policy-wide discussions about them. How do we make sure that the young people who are in those exceptional circumstances, and there's a wide variety of them, get that fair opportunity?
They still do. So there is still an So we've retained, and I perhaps should have said that at the start, we have, although it's not an appeal, we have retained an exceptional circumstances service, which is precisely for individuals in that set of circumstances, and those learners are resulted on results day. So it's not really part of a post-result service, an appeal. So if it, in effect, we've retained alternative evidence for those that need it most, and around we will produce. I don't think we've published figures as yet. But pre-pandemic and during the normal course of things, there's usually around 5,000 entries, which would be in that kind of who would be taking up the exceptional circumstances service. So for those learners who are unable to take an exam for as you've said, for personal reasons or reasons of illness or bereavement or other things, or where there's been disruption. For some reason on the day of the exam, and that can again be for a variety of reasons, the centre can make an exceptional circumstances request.
But this is still...
Can you drill it down, please?
Yeah, sorry. Thank so that's covering some young people, but not all. So, for example, the young person who... I've dealt with casework like this. Young person whose parent died the day before the exam but really felt that they wanted to go in and do the exam.
they're having to make a choice there. Do I think I can perform well enough in the exam, or do I make a choice to take the exceptional
circumstances? They would still be covered. They could still be covered by exceptional circumstances.
Right. And can I just finally...
I think that's really important.
I've got lots of...
It doesn't include those simply who did not take the exam.
Did the young people in the learner panel support this change? And what organisations who represent young people's rights, so for example the Children and Young People's Commissioner, did they support the change to the script remarking service this year?
So we... I don't have a list of every stakeholder who agreed or disagreed, but what we did was we undertook the evaluation which highlighted the issue of fairness. And
just for time, because I'm conscious of taking up other members' time, the young people on the learner panel then, did the learner panel support this?
My recollection is that the learner panel had some concerns about the return to the review of scripts. However, we engaged with the breadth of stakeholder interests. We undertook survey work of 2,000 learners, 1,000 practitioners, 500 parents and carers, appointees, and those issues of fairness I have a responsibility not to ignore. Yeah. And I have to say, I have dealt with a number of difficult cases this year. You highlight your constituency cases. Well, I get obviously representation from a number of MSPs and others during the course of the year. I have to say, I found it quite difficult to deal with cases in which a learner had an expectation of an award from their school, and the evidence did not support that expectation, and through no fault of their own, because either they had not been assessed appropriately or the judgment had been made incorrectly. So I have a responsibility around fairness as well. Now, I realise that there may be some stakeholders who disagree or agree, but I also have a responsibility around fairness. And actually, I'm not aware of any other country who have an appeals service on the basis of alternative evidence. Most exam boards, most regulators determine an appeals service which is based on the assessment approach on which the appeal is based. So I understand the concern. We've done as much as we can to ensure that those learners that need it most still have access to a service that can utilise some alternative evidence, and actually a wider range of alternative evidence, whilst maintaining fairness to an appeals process.
Thank you.
Fiona, for making that quite clear. Pam Duncan-Glancy, sup from yourself, and then I know Michelle Thompson's also wanting in.
Thank you, I appreciate that. And my colleague Ross has covered this in quite some detail. Can I just check something you said?
Yeah.
When you said that 3 in 10 appeals are successful on alternative evidence, but that's higher than the number of appeals that are successful on the script approach, is that what you said?
Well, I think what I said was that I think it wasn't appropriate to compare the two because of the differences in approach.
Okay.
Because the pre-pandemic approach, and I don't have the outcomes for this year's appeal service because we're still working on it. So we're working through nearly 40,000 appeals at this time, and we will do that, and we will publish information on those appeals outcomes. I don't have a degree of predetermination about an appeals outcome. The appeals outcomes are based on evidence, and they will be what they will be. You know, so there's no predetermination about one appeal service being better than another. The fact is, the appeal service from last year was based on an estimate being higher than the resulting grade. I would have expected, other things being equal, for the success rate for appeals last year to have been higher than it was, because it was purely based on the estimate. It was purely based on the estimate. So therefore, if there was integrity to the estimate, the appeal should have been successful. The point is that when we looked at the evidence to support the estimate, and we looked at the assessment evidence, both in terms of sufficiency and standard, only 3 in 10 were successful. And the reason that we did not continue, and albeit that we had made no indication that we would continue, the reason we didn't continue with that appeals process was on the basis of fairness.
So on that basis, then, earlier you said that the the assessment was based on a balance of exams and coursework. So can you explain then the variability of evidence that you've said has caused some of the concern around the alternative evidence approach?
So the alternative evidence approach for appeals was based on the assessment evidence that was held by the centre. Okay. Our appointees, again, working teachers, were those that were involved in making the determination around whether an appeal was successful or not. And as I've said, that there were issues around the breadth of that evidence. Did the evidence cover an appropriate amount of course material? Mm-hmm. And was the judgment on that course material appropriate? So there's two elements. There's the breadth and the standard.
Okay.
I'm going to move on to next somebody else's supplementary.
And schools and colleges and centres will have utilised a number of different forms of evidence in making that determination.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Can I move to Michelle Thompson and then Liam Kerr, please?
Thank you, Convener. Staying on this theme, I refer to an article from Test Scotland from the 7th of July, in which it noted that attendance at school has historically been a problem, but COVID has exacerbated it. So the long shadow of COVID still reaches, particularly into certain socioeconomic groupings. So I wanted to know how you had reflected on that in your decision making around removing alternative assessment evidence, that there's still these significant pockets of children for whom attendance has fundamentally shifted.
Yeah, I mean, I think attendance per se did not feature in the decision around moving from one appeals process to another. And in fact, you know, the attendance issues in isolation would impact potentially on both, or can impact on both achievement, but could also potentially impact on alternative evidence too.
That's what I'm saying.
No. However, I mean, I think in terms of the first part of the evidence that we provided at the session where we've been talking about our grading approach, I think what we have been very mindful of, and this both this year and last, in playing our part in providing support to learners, and in doing what we can as a national awarding body, is that we recognised that we needed to take that generous approach last year and continuing with that generosity through the sensitive approach this year. So I think what we're recognising is that learners have had very significant challenges over the last few years, and therefore it's been important that we've played our part in assisting and supporting that. And that's why we've done what we've done. But absolutely, school attendance plays into the impacts of the pandemic and that legacy of the pandemic.
I think one of the key fairness points for us was you might have somebody in one school and somebody in another school making an appeal based on alternative evidence, and whether or not it was successful or not depended on how well the teacher understood the requirements of the course and the standards and the judgments that they'd made, and the appointees who are teachers and lecturers who looked at all the evidence in the alternative appeals service were really quite disheartened really at you know, some of the packages of evidence they saw and how it didn't back up the estimates that had been made. So, but that is not in the hands of the young person. If you like, I'm at one school and I'm dependent on my teacher, you know, making an estimate and having good evidence to back that up. Yeah. But I might be sitting in a school where the teacher, she might be a great teacher, but they might not be good at that particular aspect. And I don't have a choice about that. So that's where the lack of fairness for the learner for us comes in, because it was dependent upon the school and their understanding.
Yeah, and that's where I'm a wee bit confused. This concept of fairness has a multitude of variables, some of which you set out there. And I'm merely reflecting that perhaps another element of this fairness is the fact that there are still significant longitudinal effects of the pandemic in pockets of society, of which attendance, which TES Scotland, I should have quoted, put in 90.9%, which is historically lower. This was their own estimates, I should point out. So I'm merely noting that, but I'll let other people come in.
I think the only thing I would add is that, you know, learning and teaching comes first, and the support that individual learners get, whether that's encouraging them to come to school or and other things, obviously is in the hands of the school and where appropriate the local authority. I think none of us are underestimating the challenges that the education system has experienced over the last few years and therefore there's a system piece here around around the support that's put in place. I mean, I think as a national awarding body, it's actually very difficult for us to address differential disruption to learning. And we had this conversation earlier in the year when there was industrial action by teachers in schools and in some cases some targeted industrial action in schools, which meant some schools were closed and some schools were open. It's actually quite difficult for us to make adjustments to awarding to allow for that. I hope there would be an acceptance by the committee that would be very difficult for us to do. However, we can deploy flexibilities, and we do. So, for example, in that case in the spring, we made adjustments to visiting verification, where we go out and undertake assessments in the school. So we were able to offer some flexibilities to schools to help address some of that. But there are, I think, I have to just be honest and say, as a national awarding body, there are limits to what we can do to address that difference across Scotland. Learning and teaching Thank comes you. First, and the support that learners get in their school, in their classroom, it comes first.
Thank you for that. Liam Kerr, thank you for your patience.
To close out on the appeals process, you pointed out that there was a pre-pandemic system, a during-pandemic system, and what we have now, a post-pandemic system, if you like. What's your early thinking on the future system going forward? Is this year's now the standard for appeals structures, or will there be further revisions?
Well, I think I've highlighted my commitment, and we have undertaken full evaluations of our awarding approach both last year and the year before, and we will do so again this year. But I think we have made adjustments to our appeals process which recognise that we've now got a direct appeals process for learners, so learners can make that decision themselves. And it's a free service, and that's quite different to the pre-pandemic, but it is based on the assessments. It's based on the assessments that they've undertaken. So we will obviously, as part of our evaluation, consider whether there are any further changes to be made. But I don't expect there to be a full iteration in the coming year. So I wouldn't expect there to be significant changes to our appeals process this year. But we will reflect if we need to on the basis of the evidence that comes through from this year's resulting. And as I say, we've delivered priority appeals, so for those learners that are going on to university or for which their results are important for their next step, so we've delivered on that already. We're now going through standard appeals. We hope to result those before the end of next month, and we will publish the outcomes of those, and then we will see what the evidence tells us.
Thank you very much. We're going to take a different tack now, away from appeals, and move on to some of the reform topics. I'm back to Michelle Thompson with this line of questioning. Thank you.
I want to just allow you the opportunity to just get some stuff on the record. I mean, you'll be aware I'm new to this committee, but I have had pretty extensive experience with large so-called transformation programmes in corporate life, and they're invariably difficult, time-consuming and expensive. So I just wanted to reflect on where we are with that. The decision to abolish the SQA must have a resultant impact on the morale of your staff. So I wanted to get your reflections on that, and also to hear more about, from a leadership perspective, what you are doing to maintain morale in the organisation.
Well, thank you for your question. I mean, as you've highlighted, you know, that organisational reform, yes, it can be difficult, mm-hmm. it can be time-consuming, and it can be expensive. Obviously, the then Cabinet Secretary for Education Skills in June 2021, so now 27 months ago, announced that the SQA would be replaced. And that has created uncertainty for staff. It's on the record, it's been on the record last year and the year before when I've been asked about this, that SQA is full of colleagues who have great expertise, who operate with professionalism and integrity in all that they do. And we've talked substantially in this session today about the work that SQA has continued to do over this period to deliver for learners every year, and every year before and every year since. We will continue to do that. I think it's important to highlight that with organisational reform, it will be absolutely critical that we can maintain continuity of delivery over that time. We can't stop what we're doing to allow for organisational reform to take place. We have to manage that process and at the same time as continuing to deliver and continuing to improve and to continue to improve our services. So I've highlighted our appeals service is now direct to learners and it's free. That's been a service that we have delivered in short order, for example, over the period ahead. Now I think the uncertainty that the reform process has created has been difficult, and I will ask my colleague also mm-hmm. to comment on that. I think what we've sought to do with as a leadership team and in discussions with staff is to keep close to our colleagues at this time, to be honest with them about what we know and what we do not know about what's happening next. Sometimes that has been quite difficult, and to keep our focus absolutely resolutely on the job at hand, to deliver and to deliver with integrity and professionalism, as we have done over a period of time. So we've sought to keep close to our colleagues in doing that.
And sorry, but just to jump in there, so when you say sought to keep close, have you got specific regular communication sessions in place with your staff? And if you could give an indication of what they are and how frequently they are, that would be helpful as well.
Over the last couple of years, we have regular exec team sessions with all staff. Where all staff are.
How often are they?
At least a monthly basis. Okay. Obviously, there's directorates. We have obviously a series of directorates. There's lots of engagement within directorates. During the pandemic, we had regular pulse surveys, annual people surveys. All the things, and we obviously have a performance framework. We were looking not only at the performance of our of qualifications delivery, but also mm-hmm. a range of other issues. So keeping an eye on things like employee turnover, retention, etc. So all of those things we've kept a very close eye on, and obviously as part of our audit and risk responsibilities, we've been keeping a very close eye on ensuring that balance is right around the risk appetite for the organisation as a whole. So we've sought to do as much of that as possible.
But
I would acknowledge that it has been quite difficult because mm-hmm. I think it's not been possible to provide answers to staff at times mm-hmm. about what's happening or indeed what's happening next. Mm-hmm. The reform programme is a Scottish Government reform programme. This is an announcement that the Cabinet Secretary made in relation to SQA. SQA is a public body. there was an expectation, of course, that there would be legislation to create a new qualifications body, which will be necessary. We're a creature of statute. We have to have legislation in place to create a new qualifications body. The Cabinet Secretary made it clear, the new Cabinet Secretary made it clear in the summer that legislation was going to be delayed. And so there will not be a new qualifications body before 2025. So that's a considerable period of uncertainty. And I think it's really important in all the discussion and debate that's been had about the organisation and what we do and how we do it, that we continue to improve our services. We continue, we've absolutely had a big focus on our communications, including with learners, our engagement with learners. The executive team is meeting with a learner panel mm-hmm. next week as a team to discuss how learners are feeling. We're doing much more direct engagement with learners and me and my team are engaging with the wider system very proactively, and that will include closer engagement with practitioners in the period ahead. So we've continued to do that.
Okay. And in terms of legislation and the sort of operating framework, if you were in charge, is there one change you'd say, well, this is what I would like to see?
In terms of the legislation, SQA has been consistent in its wish to move from a voluntary framework for accreditation and regulation to one in which there's an expectation, and this is to benefit learners, that all publicly funded qualifications in Scotland are regulated. And that provides assurance that all qualifications, whether SQA qualifications, new qualifications, body qualifications, or qualifications provided by any other provider in Scotland, are of a high quality. At the moment, we have a voluntary system in which qualifications do not need to, are only regulated on a voluntary basis. Now, that sounds like quite a technical issue, and it is, but actually, that this is about assurance
that fundamental.
Any qualification which is offered in our schools and colleges is of a high quality. Mm. And as with my other hat on, which is as chief regulator for qualifications in Scotland, I think that's really important. And I was really heartened to hear the Minister for Further and Higher Education in his statement in relation to purpose and principles and as a result of the Withers review on the independent review landscape, mm. That his view was that the new qualifications body should have oversight for all publicly funded qualifications below degree level, because I think that's really important to give schools, colleges and any other centre surety about the quality of the qualifications that are being offered and delivered in Scotland, and that would put us in line with the rest of the UK.
Okay, thank you. I know other colleagues want to come in. So
thank you, Michelle. It's kind. Mr Kerr, Liam Kerr, a very brief supplementary before we move to Willie Rennie.
Very grateful. Do you believe the new body will be in place by the exam diet in 2026?
Well, I think the Cabinet Secretary has set out in June her expectation that legislation would be forthcoming in this parliamentary session, this coming parliamentary year. That's been set out in the programme for government. And she set out an expectation that there'll be a new public body in place by the autumn of 2025. On that basis, there is an expectation, therefore, that a new qualifications body will oversee the qualifications in 2026. I mean, the truthful answer to that question is that depends on parliamentary process, doesn't it? It depends on the passage of the legislation through Parliament and the implementation of any legislation which follows. But if all goes to plan, as set out by the Cabinet Secretary, there is no reason for me to believe otherwise that a new public body will be in place.
Brief supplementary. I was hoping for a brief response as well, but can I move to Willie Rennie now, please? Thanks.
Michelle Thompson covered the impact of the structural reform and the impact of the delay. Are you losing good people from the organisation because of the further delay?
I think we have. We certainly saw, following the announcement by ministers on the uncertainty that created, and I think it's important for me to highlight that it did take, unfortunately, a number of months for ministers to confirm that there would be no redundancies, so that jobs were safe. I think that did impact, and I think we did see an increase in turnover, and we did lose some people that we would not have wished to have lost from the organisation. And not only that, I think in that context, it can be harder to recruit. It can be harder to recruit to an organisation when the organisation is not going to exist. And indeed, for a period of time, albeit that that was resolved, and that the ministers were able to confirm by the end of 2021 that there would be no compulsory redundancies. But that's a context which is, for me as a chief executive and as Jill, a senior director in the organisation, and I think Scotland, we want to ensure that our qualifications body has the best people possible. That was difficult. So we did lose some people, and we have found in some circumstances it harder to recruit. All that said, our many fantastic colleagues have remained and remain committed and have continued to work hard to benefit learners. And we have some exceptional colleagues, many exceptional colleagues in the organisation who have remained committed to SQA and to the period ahead.
This is really interesting and quite disappointing in many ways. Did government ministers respond to your pleas for some certainty about redundancies?
Yes, they did.
And how long did that take?
It took a period of time.
What? How long?
I think a period of 5 or 6 months.
Right. So 5 or 6 months of people potentially leaving the organisation. Are you able to quantify?
I don't want to overplay it. I mean, an organisation of the size of SQA, you will see people leave for lots of reasons. And you will see people come in, mm-hmm. and that continued to be the case. And so I don't want to either underplay it. But there's no doubt that we found recruitment and retention in that environment, and to an extent continue to see recruitment and retention in this environment as more challenging than it might otherwise have been.
Can you quantify it for us?
I think that it's hard to quantify the effect, but we certainly saw the effect.
And then the further delay then, so the decision in June that there would be no legislation for a period, have you seen an effect of that at all on recruitment, or is it just compounding the same issue?
I'm not aware of a particular effect, no. I mean, I think it
does affect staff morale.
Yes.
It's mm-hmm. the prolonged period of uncertainty in relation to, you know, what is the shape of the new organisation. You know, everybody will be asking, am I going to be part of that or not?
Or how are people's role, you know, people
yeah, going
think
to
about
change.
How their roles are going to change. And
obviously we've had the publication of the Hayward Review and the Withers Review, but we don't know, you know, what the government response will be to that. So there's some frustration that, you know, when are we going to be able to make changes to qualifications, you know, and so that frustration comes through particularly from my directorate, because they would like to make changes to the qualifications to improve, you know, but obviously we have to. So you get those sorts of frustrations coming through.
In the interest of time, this is a really, really interesting topic when it comes to the people. I'm sorry, I am going to have to move on from this subject if we don't mind. We have got a lot of content still to cover, and I have now got my eye on the clock. Have you got anything further to ask in this space? Okay, thank you, Mr. Rennie. Can we move to questions now from Ben McPherson, please?
Thanks, Convener. Just briefly on that last point of consideration.
I did want to move on.
Has there been an impact on your international work, which I know is quite significant? There's been a focus on the domestic, but no. could be succinct.
Yeah. Well, I mean, our international work, I mean, I think it's an important point. There's a broad point in relation to reform in the context of the brand of SQA actually having quite a lot of recognition overseas.
Exactly.
So actually, you know, SQA and the work of SQA, the work of and Scottish education is seen positively overseas. So the move to a new organisational name will potentially mean some things that we just need to manage because that, so. I think our international work, obviously over the pandemic and the period since the pandemic, has been subject to some fluctuation in a way that you might expect. We obviously had some assurance from the government should that be required for our international partners around our organisational ongoing concerns. So that's been dealt with in the normal way, and we've continued to see some growth in some of our markets. But there has been in some cases there's been a bit of a pandemic effect. But overall, I think we still.
I'm conscious of the convener, so I'll,
yes.
If there's anything further on that you wanted to add, please follow up in writing.
Yes, I'm happy to. I'm happy to provide further information.
Thank you very much. Moving on to considerations around the delivery board, I'd be grateful if you could share what the target operating model for the new qualifications body will be.
Sorry, could you just repeat the question? So, I didn't catch the final part
sure,
of the question,
my apologies. I'd be grateful if you could just set out what the target operating model for the new qualifications body will be.
What it would be?
Yeah.
Yeah, so... So as I highlighted, in my answer to Ms. Thompson in relation to the reform programme, we've been part of a Scottish Government reform programme and a number of pieces of work, and there was a strategic group being set up and delivery boards, a delivery board for SQA to take forward some work in relation to the National Qualifications Body, which includes a range of stakeholders, and there's been a similar board for the setting up of the new inspectorate and the new national agency. So that's been the setup of the governance arrangements in relation to reform. As part of that, we were asked to develop a target operating model aligned with design principles, which were broadly based on the design principles that were that were brought forward by Ken Muir in his report to in relation to the work that he did as part of the reform programme. And the delivery board oversaw the production at the government's request of a target operating model, otherwise known as TOM. And that was to be prepared and submitted to the government in June of this year, which we did. I think we made it clear, and actually one of the points I was going to mention in relation to Willie Rennie's question in relation to reform more generally, is there's something really important in any organisational reform, which is function followed by form. So, you know, function first, so form follows function. And I think one of the uncertainties in relation to the new qualifications body was in relation to function, and not least given the independent reviews that have been undertaken by James Withers and Louise Hayward. Put bluntly, you need to know what a new organisation is going to do before you can fully understand how it is going to operate, how it's going to be structured, and so on and so forth. And so the target operating model has been submitted to government on the basis of what we currently know. So I think I would consider the target operating model for the new qualifications body as submitted to government to be work in progress on the basis of what we knew at the time. But what we have done is aligned the target operating model around the design principles for reform, which is about being user-centred, data-focused, flexible to change coming from the operating environment, and that will be a learning organisation as well as being as being in the functional space around learning, and that we will be digital by default, that we'll be collaborative and we'll operate in a sustainable way. So we set out through some work, and that includes looking at route maps in terms of the customers that we have and the products that we currently are responsible for. We've set out some thinking around what a target operating model might look like. But as at the point at which it was submitted, there were, frankly, some missing pieces, because the Hayward Review had only just reported. There has not yet been a conclusion to the government's consideration of that report or James Withers' report. The purpose and principles, that there was some information came out in relation to that for the tertiary sector at the end of June. We've obviously also had the national discussion. And so there's a number of things that need to be considered before that can be concluded. And in relation to those design principles, if the new organisations are truly to adhere to and align with those design principles, there will need to be investment. There will need to be an investment in our systems, investment in our processes, and I'm sure that will be the case similarly for the new national education body and the new inspectorate. So there's quite a considerable amount of work still to do there. The government has also set in train some thematic reviews, which are the kind of connector pieces for the reform programme. And those are still at a very early stage, and those do absolutely feed into the target operating model. So things like digital culture, you know, there's a whole range of thematic projects. So those are still at a very early stage. And I noticed in the Spice report.
Sorry, Fiona, yeah. I am going to have to ask you to cut down your response times to these questions.
No,
and I understand the importance of this.
I appreciate that. But I think I also have to highlight
I'm sorry.
These are complex issues.
I am understanding that.
Moving over to further
questions for me, Convener. I saw that Michelle Thompson was looking to come in on this point. So.
Is it a brief?
Just now, in the interest of time.
Thank you very much. Can I now bring in Willie Rennie, please? Thank you.
This is probably the most critical I've heard you speak of the government. I think I can tell there's a frustration that there's a lack of clarity. You talked about in terms of employment, but also in terms of clarity on the function. I would quite like your view about the Hayward Review and whether you think that's headed in the right direction. Because I noticed that your chairman at the time said we must ensure that change can be delivered successfully, with a hint that perhaps the current direction of travel was in danger of not pursuing that successfully. I'd be interested in your view on that.
Well, first of all, I think I probably need to say that I don't think I have been critical of government, but I think I have a responsibility to be honest with the committee about where things currently are. And to be fair to the government, the Cabinet Secretary, on the basis of the reviews that have been completed, and on the basis of the point I've made and I've been advocating for a period of time since the announcements were made back in 2021, it is important to consider function first. And therefore, it's important that consideration takes place. So I think that's important. But in relation to the Hayward Review, I think the Hayward Review is a substantive report. I think it considers some very considerable changes to our education and skills system. And that we need to that need to be very carefully thought through, and actually organisational reform and the order of that needs to be considered quite carefully, and in order, as I've highlighted to the committee, to ensure that we can continue to deliver successfully to today's learners at the same time as preparing the ground for preparing for tomorrow's learners. And future learners. That's really important, that we need to make sure that we continue to deliver successfully at the same time as making the changes that any changes that may come from Hayward. For me, there are a number of important considerations that need to be taken forward in relation to Hayward. And we've made some points quite consistently through a period of a number of OECD reviews and another of a range of other reviews that have taken place over a period of the last few years. Firstly, that any changes to assessment and qualification should be seen along consideration of matters of curriculum design and pedagogy. So Louise Hayward's report, if implemented, would change significantly the curriculum models that were in place in our, that would be in place in our schools, and would therefore give rise to quite significant consideration of the things that learners have experience of, and indeed issues that this committee and predecessor committees have spent quite a lot of time on around subject choice, numbers of subjects, etc. If the Scottish Diploma of Achievement were accepted as something that Scotland wants to pursue, I think that there would need to be, and I think Louise has been very careful about looking at the conditions for success and the investment in the system that would be needed. I think it would be very important that such an SDA could benefit all learners, whatever their pathway, and that we consider very carefully any unintended consequences, particularly around equity and particularly around the personal pathway element of the SDA. I think there is a need to promote further integration and choice to ensure that every school is offering a rich curriculum, and I think that's at the heart of the breadth that is evident in the vision for assessment and qualifications that Louise sets out. I think, as I've highlighted to the committee, I think clear models of change across the education system, clarity of roles and responsibilities is really important. So those conditions for success and the need for sufficient investment and being clear about what is required will be absolutely critical to ensure that there's capacity. I think there's already some concerns emerging around workload implications from some of the recommendations that have come up. But not only capacity, but capabilities, systems, technology that would be required to truly make this a success. And something that I feel very strongly about from the perspective of my role as chief examiner, there's some really important issues around the principles of assessment, around, you know, validity, reliability, practicability, equity and fairness that need to be at the heart of any assessment and qualification system, and that's really important. My view is...
I am sitting here with my eye on the clock. That's 4 minutes to respond, and
I'm not going to ask any question. I think the fact that you've got a long list there is an indication of your anxiety, and I think that's a clear message to the government about the process of reform. Finished.
Thank you. And can I move finally to a question from the new Vice Convener, Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for your evidence so far, panel. I'd like to ask about SQA's communication with the profession and with young people. It had previously been a bit of a theme of criticism, and the committee had heard in the past the SQA described as an unlistening and distant organisation. I see that your SQA's position is that it does involve teachers. Teachers are integral to the work, and a note from your submission that you are committed to, and I'll quote you here, incorporating the perspectives and experiences of teaching professionals and learners in our decision-making processes. And you also say that you have a refreshed engagement programme. Could I just ask you to give us a bit more detail on that? And I suppose specifically, I'd like to hear how, if I am a teacher or a learner involved in that process, how I know that the SQA are listening and responding and reflecting back, you know, the diversity of views that are out there.
Yeah, thanks very much. So just firstly on a communicate, because I think there's two aspects to this. There's communication, you're imparting messages about what's happening or what's And that I think then there's engagement, which includes in discussion and debate about decisions that we need to take. So I think I'll start with communication. I think I would acknowledge when I started in this role that a lot of our communication with learners was through centres, you know, so that we focused on communication with schools with the expectation that those messages would be passed on. And indeed, in many cases, they were. But there was very little direct communication between SQA as an awarding body and individual learners. And that's something that we've sought to substantially address whilst maintaining that, obviously, that very important relationship that learners will have with their school. So we've done much more direct engagement, or direct communication, first of all, with learners. And that includes, for example, this year, you know, booklets in relation to national qualifications and everything you need to know. And I actually wrote to every learner in Scotland directly with information on our new appeal service. There was no ambiguity and no uncertainty about what that was, and that included key dates, included a full explanation of what things were. We've also increased our communication on a range of social media challenges, channels, to ensure that we're reaching learners directly, and we've had some good feedback, and indeed. We've engaged with learners themselves on what those good channels might look like to ensure that it is hitting the mark. And we've had some good feedback. And we've got some really good data in relation to the reach of our communications this year, which is in some cases up to 300%. So I think we've got some really good data analytics on the reach of our communications with learners. Again, similarly with practitioners, I think there's been a range of approaches that we've taken. There's a weekly centre news which goes to every centre in Scotland, which includes core messages.
Fiona, forgive me, I'm trying to catch your eye there, but I've not managed to. I think that sounds really positive. I wonder, because I can feel the convener's eyeballs on me. Okay. Will we move to the engagement bit? I think you've given some good examples there of direct communication.
So we have a group of around 4,000 practitioners, learners, parents, carers, who we can survey at any time. So we've been using a variety of tools as part of our research to elicit views on a range of issues. We also, over the last 3 years, I've chaired the National Qualifications and the HNVQ groups, which include a group of national stakeholders. And in 2021, for example, the National Qualifications group met every single week to talk about the decisions that we needed to take in relation to, and to provide advice on the decisions that we needed to take. That's also combined with a communications group, so that we're engaging on how we're communicating with learners. Jill's directorate, at a more granular level, have a range of national qualifications subject teams, which are groups of subject practitioners. We're currently looking at that approach, seeing if we can widen that approach so that we are...
Let me jump in again, sorry, at the risk of being rude here. I suppose I'm reflecting on a response that was given to Ross there, and mm-hmm. I think Ross Goodyear, about a decision being taken that one section wasn't contentment. Yeah. I think you said the young learners panel, I believe. I think it's interesting how organisations feed back when they're not going to do what they're surveyed people would like them to do. Could you speak to how that decision to I can't even remember what the decision was now, apology, to do something different? Yes.
Yeah, well, I think the engagement is important, and the quality and integrity of that engagement is important. But I'm sure the committee is aware that in education there is usually a variety of views on most things. Mm-hmm. And we have to make decisions, and we have to make balanced decisions on the basis of the responsibilities that we have and the feedback that we hear. And actually, most organisations have to.
So how? Absolutely, we get that.
So we have,
how did
so
you
we
do
have
that?
To do that. So we have to do that. So we obviously have we seek to collect views. We undertake evaluation. So we this. I appreciate that. my answers are long because there is a multi-layered approach
so
here.
I guess I'm asking about a specific example so that you can give me a quite short answer back, because it's not about the wider thing. Yes. It's just an example of how the organisation might do that.
Yeah. I could give you an example and maybe follow up afterwards on how we've conducted the evaluations of 22 and how we will do it for 23. So it's a range of survey work, focus groups, engagement with
I'm
a
sorry, region. I'm going to interrupt.
I understand what you're saying. You're talking about how we feed back the decision, and the, is that what you're talking about?
So, what I'm looking for is, and completely understanding the range of views, the range of people you speak to, we had an example there of where one of your stakeholders' views wasn't taken forward for presumably completely understandable and legitimate reasons. As a reflection of how you're communicating well with your stakeholders, how did you manage that in telling them why and how did you tell
them? I think we try quite hard to have to continue that conversation about the decisions that have been taken. And of course, a decision like the appeals approach needs to be taken through our advisory council, our qualifications committee, and then it's finally a decision of our board. And there will be formal communication in relation to that decision, but there will be ongoing engagement with those groups. So the learner panel, for example, is ongoing engagement with that group about the feedback that they've provided and the decisions that we've had to take. And that's what we do. And that's an ongoing process in the normal way.
I'll accept this. It's maybe in the way I'm asking the question, but I don't feel like I'm getting an answer there. And I don't know if it's reflective of the communication style of the organisation, or
I'm not sure I'm understanding your question.
Okay.
Apologies,
okay.
But I think what I'm trying to say is that we are seeking to make evidence informed decisions that are the culmination of engagement and discussion, and that feeds into a formal process as we are obliged to do as a public body, including through our board. And that we will feed back the decisions that we have taken in a variety of ways, both formally and informally, as part of our ongoing engagement with different groups.
Okay.
And I think that's what...
That's helpful.
I think that's...
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Vice Convener, for drilling down there. Can I now thank the panel for their time today, and the public part of our meeting has now concluded, and we will consider our final three agenda items in private. Thank you.